Everybody, Gutter and Bird here, and we're here with another one of the worst movies on YouTube.
Well, what?
And speaking of well, what? Guess what? It's called a Koontz edition. This month's Call to Koontz is slightly more enjoyable than last month's because there is less footage taken from other movies.
Yes.
Actually, I think this movie had a lot of its footage taken and put into other movies.
Was it Nick Miller the hell and back?
There's no such thing as Nick Miller anymore. It's a straight Ron Koontz.
It's a straight Ron Koontz.
We were going to review Ron Koontz's second movie because we're like, there is no way in hell that this has footage from
second one.
It had footage from his first movie. So Ron Koontz has been Ron Koontzing it from the very fucking beginning.
Yeah, afraid so. I mean, you look through a ton of his movies, and every single fucking one, man, you were like, oh, there it is. There's that scene, you know? Scared that man, right?
But anyway, we did The Truth. Yeah. And it starts off with Ron Koontz-like titles, you know, in like basically every Ron Koontz movie.
They look like they're from Atari, straight out.
And then it cuts to Ron talking to a dude in the dark, where you can barely see either fucking one of them.
Or hear half the time.
I'm warning you. I'm going to boost my hands, my bare feet if I have to.
Well, what we got here is a big mouth for a big man.
You're like a stick. Come on.
And then fucking Ron knocks him the fuck out.
As Ron is known to do.
Yeah.
You know what I mean? He'll have like a calm conversation and then he just thunder kick.
There wasn't much thunder kicking or action in this one whatsoever. There was lots of coffee talk.
This movie should have been called
Coffee Talk. Yeah. So whatever, they put Ron and Joe, I guess, for that fucking fight or whatever.
Well, he does look like he's got Mike Myers' wig from Saturday Night Live when he did that, you know, played the lady.
Yeah. And then he fights these dudes like this. It's fucking amazing.
Dude, he did some Aikido. Like, you know?
He moved faster than fucking Steven Seagal does nowadays.
Fucking A, he did. Anything moves faster than Steven Seagal.
Except when there's donuts involved, because then he runs like a motherfucker to him. But anyway, moving on. We cut to this push-in on Vernon. Like, and then we see the rest of the guys that are in this office, and they are fucking cops.
Office.
And they're all talking.
Office.
Okay, I'm
bedroom.
Sorry.
Bedroom.
Office.
/ bedroom.
And they're all talking about Ron.
Right.
Here.
Dave, it's good for you and the rest of us that this man Jess is out of the way.
Yeah, I set him off for a while, and he invited himself on women who would not take no for an answer.
Yes. But when her husband intervened, he killed him.
Yeah, it took three of us to bring him down.
Yeah, I thought we had him off the streets for good. But after serving 7 years, he's back on the streets.
Yeah, he's been threatening to kill me and take advantage of my wife after I'm gone.
He probably would have, too, if it wasn't for Mr. Riker, the man you got locked up.
Yeah, Dave. And it's going to be up to you to prosecute.
Well, Vernon is like...
Vernon's a sheriff, anyway.
He's sheriff. He's a sheriff. But sheriff don't have a fucking desk.
Yeah.
Why doesn't sheriff
He just has a chair in the corner.
He just has a chair in the corner, and then you have, like, a receding hairline on this side, and then...
This other guy has no qualities that are weird like the rest of everybody else in this movie.
So he's out. So because he doesn't look like a weirdo. Okay. But that's it. Like, there's no desks. There is coffee there.
Yeah, there's an empty coffee pot the whole way through this fucking
thing. Empty, but it's there. just in case for emergencies.
So whatever, they bring Ron in, and they talk about, like, you know, what happened the night before, Ron being in a mental hospital for 20 years, the whole fucking deal here.
Mr. Riker,
we've run a background check on you. You've spent 20 years in the hospital for the criminally insane before being released. What I'm asking is, what brought you here?
I've been writing a lady in this area for the past 14 years. I promised to see her when I got out.
You stated when you turned yourself in, you went to a business to ask for directions. You heard a scream. When you intervened, the man sat in on you.
That's true, but I must confess, I threw the first blow.
He ran an illegal business. He's probably beating up on one of his hookers. And he'd have beat up on you too if you hadn't have beat him to the draw.
We need privacy with the prisoner. Will you excuse us?
Sure. Got things I need to do anyway.
So he was in a mental hospital for 20 years.
Yes.
And they just let him go.
Yes.
Because he was shackled when they sat his ass down.
Well, because he was already out. He killed that fucking dude, Lambeth, which he's killed in like three other fucking movies.
Keeps killing his ass.
But anyway, yeah, that's why he was in jail the second time.
Yeah, okay. You think that's it? You think Ron Koontz is like Highlander? He's killing the same dude in every movie. You know,
The Highlander killed multiple fucking dudes.
Oh, did he?
Yeah, because remember the first one, it was, what, Clancy Brown, wasn't it?
Oh, yeah.
And then
I didn't
second
really watch the shit too much. I just, you know.
Well, because the second one's one of the worst movies ever fucking made.
Catching bits of it, yeah. I was never, like, a big fan of fucking Lambert anyway. But after, I really wasn't after fucking Mortal Kombat. I was like, oh, fuck me.
There are a few movies that he's really good in. There was a movie that was a prison one that was really fucking cool. I can't remember what the fuck it was called. But then the second one took place in a space prison with Pam Grier as the warden.
Really?
Yeah, dude, I cannot remember what they're fucking called, but I loved those two movies. They were so, like, shittily great. I'm going to have to look them up.
I have
to find both of them.
Pam Grier.
But anyway, back to Ron fucking Koontz.
I was mesmerized.
So yeah, after all that, what are they going to do? You think they're going to put him in jail for killing fucking Lambeth and breaking his neck and stuff?
Well, he is a murdering piece of shite.
No, this is what they're going to do here.
Go visit this lady you've been riding. Get on out of here.
So, you're turning loose.
That's right, Mr. Riker. We're turning you loose. You're a free man. You can pick your belongings up out front at the desk.
Well, you're free to go do whatever you want to do.
No, what he wants to do is ride in a car with Chip Drift off face, because that's what it fucking cuts to. Chip Drift off face driving Ron down the fucking road.
And Chipper Bluffface has he's got the most protruding upper lip I've ever seen. Like, it's out here and his bottom lip's down here. Like, who shaped his face?
But whatever, they have this conversation here.
God spills coffee that day. Oh, fuck.
Well, I just want to thank you for stopping for me. You know, it'd been a long walk if it weren't for you.
Glad to help. Where are you from?
Well, I'm from the mental hospital. I've been there for 20 years.
Is that right?
Yeah, I came to... been writing a woman in these parts for the last 14 years. And I've been wanting to go see her. That's where I'm headed right now.
So it cuts from them in the car to now they're out in the fucking woods, right? And they're walking through the woods and they're having this little bit of a conversation here.
You know, there's been a lot of snow up there the last couple of days, and I don't think I'm going to be able to drive up there. Mrs. Manning lives up there at the top of the hill, and I just thought I could go try to drive up there.
Well, I tell you, I thank you for the ride, and I never did ask you your name.
My name's Steve Thomason.
Well, it's really nice to meet you, Mr. Thomason, and I guess I'll be on my way now.
Okay.
So to get to the woman that he's been writing to over the last 20 years. I guess there's no other way to her fucking house, you know? You have to pull off to the side of the road, walk through the fucking woods, and then run up a fucking hill like Ron fucking Koontz does.
Okay, so, like, but she's got electricity. She's got a fridge.
Well, we didn't get to that yet because at the top of said hill is this single wide.
Oh, did we mention the fact that if we let it go, he'd be running forever.
Yeah.
Because that hill was long.
Like any Ron Koontz movie, if we left the running scenes going, they would last forever.
I will say
ever.
This. There was that one shot where he was just booking it, and it didn't cut. It was just him. Fucking dude, you knew it was him.
Yeah.
You know what I mean?
It always is.
Right. I knew that. He doesn't have a stunt double. I'm just saying they didn't cut or anything.
Unless it's from another movie.
No, it was just like one long shot of him fucking booking it up the hill.
Like it always is.
Right. So, like, yeah. Listen to me. Now, me and you could not make that trip. Me and you would have gone halfway up the hill like...
But anyway, he's at the top of the hill. He goes to the door and knocks, and can you guess who's on the other side of this door?
Scared Head Man?
No, of course not. It is this gorgeous lady right here that invites him in, and they have this conversation.
Have a seat now. Eat your cup of coffee.
Well... I guess you realize I've been away for 20 years, so I don't believe you're expecting a real young man.
No. I think I'd have been disappointed if you'd been as young as your picture showed.
Well, have you been making it?
Been making it pretty good. How's life been treating you?
Well, I'm just glad to get out. You're right about your dog being killed. I didn't know. Did you want to go out and visit his grave?
Well, we could, if you want to. I mean, a lot of guys ain't all that interested in things like that. But I am glad that you showed an interest.
He's like, well, I still like giving you my wiener.
So blah, blah, fucking blah. They're still talking and walking and talking and walking. And who gives a fucking fluck?
It's a very nice scenery behind them, though. The sun was setting, you know what I mean? And while they were walking, I was like, yes. It's come to this. They're finally going to make love.
They did not.
On the snow. I think he's just going to take it like a wild animal. You know what I mean? And just take her down and like his fucking wig would fall off onto her face. You know what I mean? So like he wouldn't be able to see her face anymore. It'd just be like the inside of his wig and he would just go to town on it. Like a werewolf.
Okay.
Is that disturbing?
So anyway,
that was my dream.
Moving on from that, we move on to Ron and the bad guy from Iron Sheriff here. You know, he's a cop and they're talking here.
Do you feel that we made a mistake by not pressing charges?
No. With Jesse's record, it's no solution. And I don't like losing. And besides, the trial costs the taxpayers money.
Well, just keep in mind that this man is responsible for putting two people in the ground. If he could have had a trial, he could have possibly got back into the hospital and off the streets.
We're all subject to making mistakes.
So blah, blah, fucking blah. Ron and this gorgeous fucking lady here are having this fucking conversation about their lives.
I'll see you back.
Yeah, I just got to think about this good cooking and I couldn't stay away that long.
You want some coffee while you're waiting?
That would be great.
Well, how do you like it out here in the country?
Oh, I think it's great. I mean, what I'm saying, I've been away for 20 years, and I got adjusted to it, to the small world. But after getting out, I just love the country. I just love getting out to myself and beautiful locations. And I realize that I'm not that much out of touch with reality. I mean, they put a man on the moon before I was sent off. I drove a car. And I did my reading. Really, the only difference I can see is just that the gas tanks, they flash now instead of the numbers roll. I guess this is what you call the computer age.
Yeah. You ain't got a good education, you can't even hardly cut gas anymore. That's why I like it out here in the country where it's plain and simple. Neighbors ain't coming over to borrow sugar or want to sit and yap all the time before you can't get your work done. I love the country.
Offered him pork chops. Look, your woman offers you pork chops, right? And then she's like, you know what? After them fucking chops, I was just going to chill and listen to some music. And maybe I'll let you go down on me.
She did not say that because I would have vomited in my mouth. But
Rod didn't want to do really that.
He wanted to go drive his fucking car around, which doesn't happen until later anyway.
I guess it's the sick side of us that just wants to see a sex scene. You wanted to see him on top of a romp.
No, I want to see him having sex with another movie.
You want to have them sex with another movie?
Yes, we've talked about this before.
How is it impossible?
Okay, Ron shirtless.
Right.
With the camera where it normally is.
Okay. Oh, that shot.
And then it cuts to another movie where there's some other person having sex with this woman. It's all built like fucking Arnold Schwarzenegger style. And then it would cut back to Ron with his fucking face and his front butt.
Oh my god. I don't know if I want to go down as far to his front butt because he's down there. Little Koontz. I don't think you want all that. You know, if you're talking about a shoulder length shot of him all sweating profusely and shit, yeah, that's fine.
So moving on, we cut to Ron filming a family reunion. It's like one of the fucking scenes, but it's this whole fucking family and they're all in this fucking house. And a lot of these scenes were used for like six other fucking movies. So now the family's talking about fucking the gorgeous lady and how crazy Ron is. Here's some of that.
I heard Stevie brought up a crazy man from the mental hospital.
Heard he was staying up at that Manning woman's house.
I went to see that woman to buy some sugar and she charged me double the price of what it normally is. I guess that's her way of saying she don't want any company.
Scared that man hanging around here.
And then Perm Mollet comes in and talks to the men about Ron, so here's some of that.
Dude, she had a chia pet on her head.
I would suggest we invite this man out, have a talk with him.
Not in this house, not around the children.
I feel I'm a good judge of character. The man may be okay.
Okay, but they better not be any trouble.
And you want to know what it cuts to next? Something I would have never, ever expected. Ron and this gorgeous lady having a fucking snowball fight.
Yeah. Hey, whatever. And that was the part where I was like, there you go, man. Like, you know, they got a steamy connection. Got steamy. I don't know what you want to call it. You know what I mean? But they're playing around. You know what comes next. You know, hee hee ha ha. You know, and then let me get them titties, bitch. You know that happens. You know what I mean? I mean, sure. Throw snowballs at bitches and get titties. That's what happens. Never mind.
Okay.
But I don't know what I was saying. Continue.
You never know what you're saying. Okay. So now we cut to Vernon and the guys. And then Donnie Chester comes in. I'm like, yes, Donnie Chester. So this movie's got Vernon and Donnie Chester. A lot.
You have a hard-on for Donnie Chester.
And Vernon. But not like a physical hard-on, a mental hard-on. That sounds even weirder. Moving on. So now we cut to Ron and Gorgeous drinking coffee and talking about her criminal ex here.
You know, before we started writing, I'm sure there was someone else in your life.
Yeah. Someone I really don't care all that much to talk about, but I thought he was really in love with me, and, well, after I got to know him, and we dated for quite a while, and I was falling in love with him. Until one morning I woke up and he was gone and the car was gone. My car. It wasn't until later till I found out that he had a record that, well, it was penny theft and breaking in houses and taking different things. Well, I guess they finally caught him on all them charges.
Well, whatever happened to him?
Well, he went to prison, and I don't know exactly how much time he got. Tell you one thing, though. I'll never forget that lesson.
Dude, that's beverage of choice.
In the Koontz household? Everybody. Yeah, yeah. Fucking A, man.
In the whole town, that's all they drink is just straight up coffee.
So blah, blah, fucking blah, we cut back to Donnie and Vernon and stuff having another conversation about Ron here.
What is it with you, Sheriff? You know this man killed over 20 years ago. You know that he was released from the Biloxi Mental Hospital. You know that he was there when Jess Lambeth's neck was broken. Now, how many more people are going to have to possibly die before you come to accept reality?
And after like 4 or 5 shots of the river, which happened throughout this fucking movie, Ron now talks to us, because he's looking directly into the camera, about the river. Here's this.
The river. The river's sometimes deep or shallow, red or cloudy, clear or muddy. The river's warm, it's calm and rugged. It's cold and frozen, yet still flows on. He carries small tugboats and great big barges and ocean liners wherever they go. It takes people from town to country, from city to continent. Yet the boats travel slow.
Dude, there were so many times throughout this film that you could not understand a word these fuckers were saying.
That's I mean, it was on just, par with every other Ron fucking
movie. I know, but
like,
it was really bad
is.
In this one, man. It was a problem. Like, words were coming that I did not utter. I was like, well, that wasn't even English, you know?
Speaking of not speaking English,
me.
Chip Ripped Off Face appears.
Miss Manning told me I'd find you out here.
Tell you how to get my
place,
Mr. Rocker. Can we invite you out one night?
That sounds
great. Sounds
good. Yeah, I'm looking forward to it. Just give me your number and I'll let you know what time to head down and get back to you.
I'll still do that.
And brings him to the family house.
That must be that crazy man.
Y'all go on outside and play.
Checkers.
And they talk about work and lack of work here. This is some craziness.
I guess you'll be looking for work.
Well, I wish I was able to work, but I'm having a lot of problems with my breathing. I got emphysema and bronchitis and all, and quite a few back problems. Been trying to get disability, and I hope maybe before long I'll be able to get a little help.
Well, if you'd lay off them cigarettes, you might be able to go to work and do something.
I know the doctor told me I'd be on a breathing machine 3 or 4 years from now if I didn't quit this smoking, but I like my cigarettes.
I don't have to work. I've been drawing for about 6 months.
So he brings him to the family house, right? And I love it that Ron, this is the part where Ron is thrusting his fucking hand.
No, it's not. Because this is whenever Beard Guy is asking Ron to help him cut off the heads of the chickens. Yes.
Because there was twice that he showed up the house. That's right. Yeah. This was the first time.
Okay. Yeah.
Now getting back to work, I got some chickens I need to kill. And I give one to you and your lady friend if you come over and help me cut their heads off.
Well, I just hadn't got what it takes to kill a chicken.
And then the conversation just switches up to Chip Ripped Off Face talking about his boss or whatever, and won't hear.
Yeah, Danny's okay, but he just has trouble getting along with the boss man.
Yeah, boss man, he walked up on the job the other day and got $1 million machine there, and he started telling me what he thinks it ought to be able to run. I told him, I said, you want to think something? I said, think next week's paycheck in here this week. I said, you done something. I said, he said, well, we need to go to the office. I said, so we went. I said, he said, I had a bad attitude. I said, well, can we smoke while we're in here? I said, needless to say, we got rode up. I got rode up.
Yeah, and you were like, what the fuck? What the fuck's he talking about?
And now we cut to Ron and this gorgeous lady sitting on two kitchen chairs in the middle of the yard in the snow having this conversation.
It's nice out here. You told me that Mr. Brian comes in and checks on you, helps you get groceries. And,
well, he knows I don't drive on the snow, and this is our sixth snow. So he comes by and we go to the grocery store and wherever else I have to go and buy stuff.
Yeah, I know that you informed me in my letter that he would work with me and help me find a job.
Yeah, I really believe he will.
So now we cut to the family talking about cigarettes and stuff.
Cigarettes.
To Shrunken Head number two. No, Shrunken Head number one, yes. Here.
I bet the man's all that dangerous. He ain't got the heart to kill a chicken.
Those cigarettes gonna kill you if you don't give them up.
Well, I told you I like them. They better than chocolate cake. I'm not gonna blame the cigarette companies.
Well, everybody's trying to get money out of cigarette companies nowadays.
Go ahead, fire them up.
If you shouldn't smoke them cigarettes gonna kill you. Like, well, yeah, I guess so. You know, if you keep doing it, you're going to die.
On that note, we cut to Ron asking Junkyard here for work.
Glad to meet you, Mr. Riker.
Mr. Brock, Miss Manning said that you might be able to find work for me.
Yes, it's a possibility. I mean, we got a lot of fence work around here that needs mending and places to be fixed and things to do. We got a lot of wood that needs to be chopped. Just got all kinds of work around here to do.
And I call him Junkyard because he looks like he would own a junkyard.
I think he looked like Sloth. Hey, you guys!
But anyway, Ron gets the job here.
He did. And he was just standing there. And he left him, and Sloth was just standing there. And he was like, you know, Like, what are you gonna do something? You know, sloth, love chunk.
So anyway, we
love Koontz.
We cut to this gorgeous lady yelling at P.I. Donnie Chester. This scene's pretty fucking awesome dialogue-wise, so here you fucking go.
Sir, do you know you're on private property? You see that darn road? Leave. Now.
Miss Manny's. I'm Detective Covey. I'd like to question you about your friend, Mr. Riker. I suppose you know he's in serious trouble.
Well, sir, I'm gonna ask you to leave this property. I don't know where Jim's at right now. So I'd appreciate it if you get yourself off of my property and you see the road.
I must inform you, Miss Manning, harboring a suspect, I could place you in serious trouble.
Well, sir, do you know you're on private property? You see that darn road, you hit it.
All right, have it your way. I'll go, but you keep in mind what I told you.
She told him off, man. She was like, get the fuck out of it. Well, she didn't do all that. But like for a straight minute there, me and you were looking like, does she have front teeth? Are they gone?
You. I was looking to see, I couldn't tell, but you were the one that was really adamant about her not having teeth. So blah, blah, fucking blah. Donnie Chester's driving this truck, and he pulls into this yard, and I'm like, son of a bitch.
Seen it.
Yep.
Simpsons did it.
So Donnie Chester pulls up, gets out of the truck, and then fucking fights these two dudes. It was just as awesome as it was in the organization as it is now.
But you've seen it.
Here you go. Watch it again.
Okay, fine.
Had enough of your rest. Good day.
So, cut to fucking Junkyard giving Ron his white Trans Am. And I mean, the white fucking car that he's, I'm pretty sure Ron has had since his first fucking movie.
Yeah.
Well, Miss Brown, it's not that I don't want it. I just don't see how I'm going to be able to pay for it.
Well, since you're coming to work for us and everything, you pay so much a week or so much a month, we'll work out something.
Well, if I get paid...
You think it's his?
And what's great is the sound fucks up for some reason here.
Farmer sample driver's test. I'm gonna drive.
It's like a fucking eagle or something fucking through.
Well, he flew through. He was saying something. Did they throw that eagle in there on purpose?
I doubt it. Nothing.
I don't know if it was an eagle. It just was like, you know, all weird and shit.
So anyway, moving on, we cut to the family talking about P.I. Donnie Chester. Here's some of this.
Tell you boys. That detective they got don't quit running around harassing me. I'm gonna put him in his grave.
Nah, you don't have to do that. Everything will blow over.
Mr. Rocker was there when Jess Lander slipped and broke his neck. The detective said that Mr. Rocker did it.
He thinks we need something on Rocker, so he's putting the pressure on us all until one of us breaks.
I got a 12-gauge shotgun. I'll deal with it myself.
And I can't remember if this was a scene or not, but we definitely got some more scared that man around here. So obviously that line was taken from this and thrown into whatever it was, Iron Sheriff.
They never leave that fucking room.
No, they do not.
The guys are in the living room. They don't leave. They don't even move there from their position. I don't even think they switch or do anything, you know? And the ladies are still sitting there with fucking Chia Pet Head. It seems like she's sitting in the doorway looking out, like you can't even get into the kitchen. And they're all just sitting there. So many times, like, the camera will pan, and you'll just see them all, like...
looking right down the fucking camera.
Or looking right at it, you know?
That's what I said, right down the fucking camera.
Yeah, right down it.
So anyway, we cut to Ron and Junkyard doing some random job of whatever the fuck it is here.
You're boarded up, and make sure everything's fixed up on them. And we got a lot of fences to mend and stuff like that. Just when do you want to get started?
Now it's good. Time's in.
Okay. Sound like a winner to me.
With the fake thunder in the background, fucking awesome.
Oh, yeah, that's, yeah. Well, yeah, but they had dialogue. There's a lot of...
I was like,
you can't hear a fucking thing.
But what do you do after hard day's work? You sit down and you have a drink with your junkyard-owning buddy. Here's some of this.
So, we're going to be making a lot of hay this year. Probably maybe around 15 or 20 acres of hay, and no telling how many sweet potatoes and strawberry plants and all that stuff we're going to be putting out. So we got a lot of work to do, so I'm pretty sure you're going to have a full-time job in front of you. All you got to do is hang in there and do the best we can. A lot of fences to mend, a different thing. So, well, we'll see what we can get done.
Yeah, I reckon I'm ready.
Yeah, I say so. Yep. I thought we're both ready to get the hay stuff.
Why do you make it sound like such a demeaning thing?
What?
Like somebody who owned a job.
No, not at all. I'm not at all, dude. Not if I can all. There is nobody that is beneath me. I am the lowest of the lowest of fucking people. I hate myself more than anybody could ever hate me, so... Yeah.
Oh, it's all about you, isn't it?
Yes. Moving on.
You hate people that you own junkyards.
No, I do not! Not at all. So blah, blah, fucking blah. Ron goes to talk to Vernon and the guys about how he doesn't want Donnie Chester around everybody anymore.
Now look, Sheriff, I'm willing to cooperate with you any way possible. But what I want is for that detective to stay away from my place.
I'll have a talk with Detective Colby.
Thank you, Sheriff.
So then, bloop, it cuts, and now Donnie Chester's in the fucking room, and Vernon's telling him, hey, back off some, man. Yeah, here's some of that.
His not-desk cabin ass.
Mr. Riker was in earlier today with a complaint.
Well, when I find a loophole in a man's story, and I can listen to his voice and look into his eye, and I kind of know when he's telling the truth or whether to go ahead and break him down.
Sometimes when a person has been falsely accused of something, they're going to be nervous.
That's a different look.
Mr. Kobe, if you have any questions concerning Mr. Riker, I suggest you do that here. Have you got that?
I'll think about it, Sheriff. I will think about it.
But you're the sheriff. You don't even have a desk. I mean, where do you put your shit?
So,
seriously, what, does he have buckets and stuff?
They must.
Drops his stuff over there and shit over here. Here's my cuffs over here and my papers and my bullets, you know. And here's my deputy. Pretty much sitting right on my lap, you know.
So we're moving on to cut to Ron and this gorgeous fucking lady having another coffee conversation. And this is the one about the pork chops. I just let it go and didn't call you out on the last time. But this is the one about the pork chops and stuff. Here's this.
I got some pork chops laid out to fix for supper. After that, I was thinking about just sit around and listen to some country music.
Well, I really appreciate you going to all that trouble, but I've been invited out with the gang tonight, Tex. They say he's a good country singer. And we just wanted to get together and just listen to him.
That sounds nice.
Well, you should have said something about the pork chops, because I was waiting for that scene. Because this is where he grabs her and throws her up on the coffee table.
That does not happen.
Rips her
shirt
off.
That does not happen.
And they fucking do
that
it right
does
there.
Not happen. Even though I do want somebody to write some Ron Koontz fan fiction porn stuff.
Ew, no, no, you want no. somebody to do that?
No, because somebody would probably be creepy enough to do that.
Mr. Cool.
Mr. Cool?
That guy who's obsessed with him. The guy on our YouTube thing keeps commenting about him.
Okay.
He's amazing.
Because he fucking is!
I know he is, but I'm just saying, if somebody's gonna... What were you talking about?
Writing slash porn or slash fic. Whatever. Moving the fuck on what from that. So now we cut to Kip Ripped Off Face taking Ron to the family's house again. And this is the scene with Ron... fucking talking with his hands, so fucking crazy.
And he just hits fucking Shrunken Head a couple of times. He was just like,
well,
you know?
Here, enjoy this.
Name of this poem is Progression. We're on our way to nowhere. We'll be there very soon. Or no one does a thing that is important and everybody sleeps till noon. The train is traveling quickly to a journey that seems so far. The timetable's well sketchy. The engine's whistle triggers the remembrance of make-believe tunes. We go through turmoils and troubles, through mountains of problems and woos. I call to imaginary conductor who collects and shuffles all burdens and woos. Why does life take us on such a journey with no concern that we can't pay the fare? For death overtakes those who ride free. And in hope of returning from their destination, still drifting, a lifetime trip to nowhere.
Man, that is some poetry there. That is some poetry.
Like, Ron, stop moving your hands around, man. You're scaring Grandma. That's why she scared that man around here, because he comes in and starts thrusting his fucking hands when he's talking. Go get me some coffee!
So anyway, we move on from that to Ron and this gorgeous lady having another conversation outside on the chairs, I think, about Ron's personal life. Here's this.
I guess I'll tell you about my personal life. Well, I hadn't been married. It's just that, I don't know. I just like being at the game. Just like getting together with the ball team and celebrating a victory. Oh, I've been with different women, but I've never got that serious with them because the responsibility of marriage, it scared me.
So far, all they've done is hold hands, though. They didn't really smooch or nothing. Is he afraid of that shit? You know, if he wants to be an all-around actor, hey, look, even Charles Bronson got it on. You know what I mean? He smooched a couple of bitches. You know what I mean? Why can't Koontz do it? I don't know why I'm pushing so hard to see him naked.
Anyway, moving on from that, we cut to Ron and Junkyard feeding cows here.
Junkyard dog.
To classical fucking music, I might add, here.
Well, what else would you do it to? Some Limp Bizkit.
And now we cut to a random shot of Ron driving his car, which has happened multiple times up to this point, but I just didn't feel like bringing him up until now. But yes, we get multiple shots of Ron just randomly driving his car around. So now we cut to Vernon and the guys talking about guns. For fucking ever. Just why? Does it have anything to do with the movie? No, a fucking course snart. Snart. A fucking
course snart.
Of course not. Here, check this out.
They ought to put a ban on the AK-47 assault rifle.
Well, I agree. But from the reports I get, most of the people are killed with small handguns. At close range, the .22 pistol is the leader.
I favor the single action army. The man that takes his time, aims, fires, he can shoot, chances are he'll keep.
Why do you say that?
Well, you think about it. Most holdups, most armed robbers, handguns are used. And most of the time, they're not standing any farther than you and I. Not all of them take good a shot.
So anyway, moving on, we cut to Ron and Donnie Chester having a conversation about the killing of Lambeth. Here's this.
Ron, Don Van Dam.
Mr. Riker, I wanted to have a talk with you. There's some things about this Jess Lambeth accident that just doesn't add up. Well, in time, Mr. Riker, you will talk.
And then we jump cut to Ron talking about the case with Junkyard here in Junkyard's fucking kitchen with the fucking drawing or whatever on his fucking refrigerator that gives him fucking antlers. Or fucking feet. Antennae.
For like a little bit there, like, he kind of looked like Phil Collins, you know?
But not Phil Collins from Genesis.
No, not
Phil
Genesis.
Collins from Trailer Park
Trailer
Boys.
Trailer Park Boys, yeah.
So,
Mr. Tiger, I think we would pick that down. You know, it's not obviously Phil Collins from Genesis. Fuck him.
So, anyway, blah, blah, fucking blah. We now cut to Ron creepily walking through elementary school.
I know.
Doing the selfie camera sometimes, but then filming sometimes.
The fucking lens was damn near up his nose.
Fucking hell. And then, okay, we're like, why is he walking in this elementary school? And then he walks through the door of the police station. So the police station's inside this elementary school?
So the police station is inside his single wide that was inside another building?
But whatever, I don't care. I'm starting to get fucking burnt out on this fucking movie. So Ron talks to fucking Donnie Chester again. Here's this.
Mr. Riker, isn't it true you were sent to the Biloxi Hospital for the criminally insane for killing a man?
Yes, that's right.
Tell me what happened.
What happened? I heard a woman screaming for help, and when I went to her aid, this madman came up with a hatchet from somewhere, but I was able to stop him.
Let me refresh your memory, Mr. Riker. You threw a kick to his stomach, knocking the breath out. Then when you had him where you wanted him, just like a kicker in football trying for a goal, you did that karate kick and you knocked him in the jaw so hard that you snapped his neck, driving his body to the ground. He was out of breath and out of commission, and you kept on in your rage. Now, tell me, Mr. Riker, isn't that what happened? Isn't this possibly what happened?
Yes, that's right. That's what happened.
And then we cut to Ron driving.
Again.
Yeah, but whatever. He pulls into outside McDonald's, gets out, and this scene happens. I love it here.
Well, Mr. Brown, it's good to see you. What are you up to tonight?
It's been good talking with you. I reckon I got to get on in and get a little supper. It's getting late in the day, you know. Take care.
I'll catch you later.
Well, see, he ordered a Grand Mac and they didn't give it to him.
No, they didn't. Well,
fucking nuts.
Yeah, fucking, that was just crazy though, man. Fucking him just like, see ya. And he just fucking walks into McDonald's. Yeah. We just follow him into McDonald's.
He sees Sloth standing there and he just goes, and it sounds like Ron's gonna say something to him. He just goes, see ya. And he dips, and Ron's just like, standing there. Like, what the fuck just happened? How did you know to meet him there? Or did you just by hand?
Ron Koontz. Yes, this movie had the most comprehensible plot of most of Ron Koontz movies, but Ron Koontz. So moving on to Ron working on this fence.
Oh, hurts my head.
When Donnie Chester comes up and they have a confrontation.
Uh-oh.
And I had such high hopes for this scene.
Oh, this was Expendables 2 right here.
But here.
I'm going to turn myself in, and I'm going to tell the truth. But just for all time's sake, just for all this harassment, I'm going to see if you back up that big mouth of yours. Oh, I'm just
Mr. Riker.
This was Sylvester Stallone Van Damme letdown.
Yeah.
That's what that was.
Because I was expecting this great fight. What happens? Donnie swings, Ron kicks him once, yeah, and then fucking helps him up.
And that was it, man. I was hoping for so much more than that. You know, just like in Expendables 2, Stallone comes up, whoops Van Damme. Van Damme kicks one time, then he whoops him again, then stabs him. And everybody was like, really?
But anyway,
you
what do you
all that for that?
And what do you think happens at the end of this scene? Ron says he'll turn himself in here.
Well, I just hadn't got the heart to hit you while you're down. Look, I'm gonna let you up. I'm gonna turn myself in, and really, I'd like you to go with me. I hadn't got the heart to kick a man when he's down. Just come on in. I'm going to turn myself in. I'd be honored to have you come.
Well, I'm glad, Mr. Rusher. I straightened this thing out.
Well, I didn't want to kick you in your stomach anymore, so I'm just going to turn myself in. So why don't I just help you up and you not get a free kick onto my balls? Yeah, right. If he helped me up, I'd be like, oh, yeah, man. Yeah! And I'd get him right in his nuts, even if I was going along with the plan or not. You know, that fucker kicked me in my stomach. You know, that shit hurt you, barf.
So anyway, moving on. We cut to Vernon and the guys finding out that Donnie Chester is not a detective. Here's what he is.
That is the information I allowed to be fed into the computer and allowed to be released to you. I knew you would be doing a background check.
Well, if you're not Detective Kobe, then who are you?
Well, Deputy, my name is Dr. Neville Winstead, Chief Psychiatrist for the Biloxi Mental Hospital. And we have a new outpatient therapy program where we monitor and keep up with the patient and see how well he can fit himself back into society. And we watch him and we evaluate him. And that's what this new program is all about.
He's a plumber.
He's a psychiatrist. And this is some kind of crazy fucking therapy where they fucking hound crazy people to see if they can push them to fucking break. And if they don't, you're healthy.
That sounds like a great plan. Dug up by idiots. Okay, so A, impersonating an officer. You know, officer,
and
you know,
yeah,
impersonating like many officers, detective, whatever else. So yeah, why didn't fucking Fish Lips arrest him right there?
And Fish Lips, you mean Vernon?
Vernon.
I don't fucking know. Why didn't they arrest Ron Koontz right there?
They should have arrested everybody right there.
So but whatever. We cut to Ron and this gorgeous fucking lady outside again, and they're having a conversation about them and like they're how they're gonna what's gonna happen after this here.
Well, I understand. It's just that I understand that you've been single for years, and me, I've been put away for 20 years, and I. Sometimes both of us have just had a chance to adjust a single life. I'm not saying that it's best. I feel that we should be fair about it. What I'm asking. I'm asking a lot. Why don't let's think about it for a year? I promise you. If I can stay up here, I'll stay in the room. I mean, when two people have been single this long, I feel that we don't make any mistakes.
Sounds real nice.
Well, that's great. Look, I just sat here and rest. I'm just going to walk down and look at the room.
after this really boring movie.
They're going to live together. And
I figured I'd throw a snowball at your head and then jump excitedly around the dog.
That didn't happen in this movie. That was a different Ron Koontz movie.
Could have been in this movie.
It really could have been.
You know, and then thank God, guys, have some more calls.
But thank God the credits come up. Oh, and then the credits are going on over top of the people that played them, which I always enjoy whenever they do that, because then you get to see what the people's names are. Because I
like an Avengers after the
credits. I only remember fucking Donnie Chester's name.
I wish we had is like a Ron Koontz after the credits ending scene. Like, you know what I mean? Like something epic or something. Or, you know, him and his
Can I have
the hottest woman in the world living eating at shawarma or something. Yeah. That'd be great.
And then, you know, it ends with Ron and this gorgeous lady walking towards the camera.
Ron Koontz's biggest attraction in his town is probably like a Dairy Queen that's been there since 1809.
So, yeah.
It has one light bulb.
Another Ron Koontz movie down. We have been doing Ron Koontz movies for almost a year.
Yeah.
Thank God we didn't do it weekly, because I would have fucking hung myself.
Yeah.
But doing a monthly is not so bad, and we're going to keep going forward. We're going to do our other crappity crap, and then Koontz, like we always fucking do, like we've been doing for months now.
Yeah, so if you see either one of us in a mental hospital, or he shows up alone, you'll know why.
Yeah, because Burr will be in a mental institution fucking talking about Ron Koontz's junk and that, and they'll be like, he's crazy, and throw away the key. So anyway, on that note, for Bird and Gutter, this has been another one of the
worst movies on YouTube.
Call it a fucking Koontz edition.
You're worried that people will get us confused, because if I say the wrong thing, they'll come for you.
That might be part of it. Maybe.
Bird said it! And they're coming out, you're like, dude, somebody's pounding on my door looking for you. You're like, I know you're in there! They can hear you!
Oh my god, it's fucking hot in here.
It is a little bit.
Yeah, I'm done.
It's because you're breathing heavy.
Ron Koontz takes a lot out of me.
I know, it's like having sex.
Yeah, because it is.
It takes effort, you know what I mean? After you're done, you're not really that sad.
It takes effort to, like, listen to a Ron Koontz movie. It takes effort to pay attention to a Ron Koontz movie.
After it's done, it's mentally draining. It's over. You're just like, oh. Yeah.
And then we gotta fucking purge it from ourselves, and then I'm really like, oh.
And then you gotta put the stuff away. That's like kind of like wiping yourself off.
Yeah, who wants to do that, but you kind of have to do it.
And then you go downstairs, and then the regret hits.
Yeah, pretty much.
I can't believe I did that.
That's a good idea. If he's dangerous, you know to stay away from him if you'd happen to see him on the streets.
Yeah. If he comes here uninvited, called in trouble, he'll curse some lead.
There's enough men around here that the women and children, they shouldn't be in any danger.
If he comes here looking for trouble, we'll fill him full of lead.
Hey everybody, Bird Gutter here.
Bird and Butter.
Hey everybody, Gutter and Bird here. It's Tuesday again, so that's not the right fucking thing.
Hey everybody, the DD is the worst the movie's on YouTube.
That's a new one on me. Dave, you know anything about this?
What is this, Detective Cody?
Just Langram died of a broken neck, and there's some question involved in this, and I believe the mental patient, Jim Raker, could be involved.
Sure, Mr. Lamb fell. It was an accident. Riker has been released from the hospital. He didn't escape.
We just told them how to make a porno with Ron. I hope to Christ they don't use that.
Well, Steve, it's good to see you out here. You know, it's a little nice. It's nice out here.
Yeah, I heard about Jess Vandal slipping and breaking his neck, but I don't believe he slipped. But I'm not holding against you.
Well, it's good to know that, but I've told the district attorney the story. Look, I believe I'm going in for a cup of coffee. Are you care to come along?
Sounds good to me.
Why don't we mess with it and we'll mess with it. But like, we should just, I don't know.
Nah, I'm going to leave it the way it is. It's perfect the way it is.
Like, redub some of his movies. It'd be so great.
No, they're perfect the way that they are.
Are they?
Yes.
I guess so. They're perfect the way they are until we start getting to the ones where they really start repeating.
This so-called Detective Kobe has been going to school and has recently got his license as a private detective.
Maybe in time he'll have to go back to work and get out of our hair.
Well, maybe so. But in the meantime, he could cost us a lot of trouble.
So blah, blah, fucking blah, Ron and Don.
Ron and Don? What?
It is Ron and Donnie.
Wait, wasn't there a fucking dance group, singing group, or whatever called?
I don't fucking know.
Well, Steve, I just want to thank you for inviting me over to meet your family.
Appreciate you running me into town. I plan on getting my car out today.
Of course, Snarf.
Snarf.
Of course, Snarf.
Detective Kobe, you're crowding us. Until you get more concrete information, I'm advising you to back off.